Cookies are small pieces of information or data that a web server sends to your browser so it can be stored on your computer's hard disk. The next time you make a request on the same website, your browser sends that cookie along with the request so that the website can identify you. Cookies can be broadly classified as first-party and third-party cookies. When you visit a website, let's say ecommerceweb.com, that displays an advertisement, understand that the ad is hosted on another server, let's say ads.com. Cookies set by ecommerceweb.com are first-party cookies, since it is set by the same website you're currently browsing. Also, ads.com that serves the ad sets a cookie for you. Now, since this is a cookie set by another website you're not directly browsing, the cookie set by the ad server is a third-party cookie. Third-party cookies are also referred to as tracker cookies. But why would companies want to do this? Well, economic incentives, like advertising for example, are a primary reason for the birth of third-party or tracker cookies. So how does third-party tracking work? Well, you may spend your free time visiting websites relevant to your interests. And it's very important advertisers know your interests. You see, displaying irrelevant ads to people means a loss of revenue and advertising funds for these companies. Ads have to be personalized or targeted for a maximum return on investment. What if you could be tracked on the web and be displayed ads relevant to your interests and browsing habits? Targeted advertising is achieved with the help of tracking or third-party cookies. I'll use Google's advertising network as an example to explain this. People or companies handling websites, web applications, or blogs are called publishers. And most publishers, apart from various other business models, resort to earning revenue through displaying ads on their website. Rather than searching or reaching out to companies for sponsorship, they reach out to third-party advertising networks like Google's. Publishers make it known through Google's AdSense program that they are willing to sell ad spaces to advertisers. This way, they monetize their website through ads. And on registering, publishers receive a code snippet or a script that they should place on their website to display ads. This way, the Google Advertising Network has a very large repository or a network of publisher websites. Similarly, advertisers or companies wanting to advertise their business reach out to advertising networks. Companies or businesses wanting to advertise their products or services could register to Google Ads program. This way, Google also has a large network of advertisers wanting to advertise on publisher websites. Now, let's assume website1.com is a publisher who has registered with Google's AdSense program. The publisher places the code snippet or script on his website to display ads. When you call for website1.com, your browser makes a request to the server and gets back a response, rendering the website on your browser. On rendering the website, the code snippet or script embedded in the website instructs your browser to request an ad from Google servers like DoubleClick.net. Google server DoubleClick.net serves the ad on the website and also sets a third-party cookie for you. Now, this third-party cookie set by DoubleClick.net is a tracker cookie. This is a unique ID set for you. When you visit another website, let's say website2.com, which is also registered on Google AdSense, your browser sends your unique tracker cookie along with the request. The Google Ads server, DoubleClick.net, recognizes your ID and makes a unique cross-site browsing profile of you. This way, as it builds a browsing profile of you through tracker cookies, Google Advertising Network knows your interests based on your browsing profile and dynamically serves ads of relevance to you. Social media websites also perform cross-site tracking of your browsing. You would have noticed numerous websites with social media widgets, like the Facebook like or the share button or the Twitter tweet button. Social media websites could track you via these widgets. However, social media websites track you with a first-party cookie, but in a third-party context. Let's say you create or register an account on Facebook. And once you do this, you are assigned a first-party cookie by Facebook that is unique to you. After this, you open website1.com, which has a Facebook like button on its page. You get back a response rendering the website on your browser. On rendering the website, the code snippet or script embedded in the website to render the Facebook like button instructs your browser to make a request to Facebook servers. And when doing this, your browser sends your Facebook cookie along with the request. So the Facebook server responds and the like button is displayed on website1.com. And this way, Facebook builds a browsing profile of you and would know if you browsed website1.com. If you want to prevent third-party tracking, for starters, you could modify your browser privacy settings. You could set it up such that your browser blocks third-party or cross-site tracking cookies. Also, switch on the Do Not Track option. You could set your browser such that it deletes all your cookies, including your first-party cookies, on closing it. You could make your privacy more robust by installing ad or script blocking extensions like Privacy Badger, uBlock Origin, or Ghostery.